ahead there, Brother Tater Tot.
Dear Holy Father, thank you for this day. I ask that we have a good service today. I ask that we just have a good time today. In Jesus' holy name, amen.
Amen, amen. Thank you, thank you. All right, let me have that, if you will. All right, well, I'm going to go ahead and pray us up, and then we will get on with our teaching today, okay? Father God, we thank you, Lord, for this day, and we do thank you for the rain, Lord. I ask you to watch over all those who are trapped in their homes and who needed rescuing and who needs help. And I pray, Lord, that you'll continue pouring the rain down on us as we need it. But just protect us, Lord. Watch over us and keep us. Father, I lift up our service today, Lord. I ask that you bless the offerings that those that give today. I ask that you bless them and bless those offerings. And also, Lord, that you bless Israel. I ask you, Lord, also to watch over the innocents that are in Gaza. And I pray, Lord, your will be done. Father, we lift up our service to you today. I pray that the children will receive the message you have planned for them, and also that you will use me as your tool, as your vessel, to bring forth the word, which is Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. We thank you, Lord, and in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. Thank you, thank you, thank you. All right, well, good morning, y'all. How are you? I hope you're doing great. We sure needed the rain. We sure got it. At least I did. I know that's a fact. Jenny and Robert were telling me that down the street from me, that we had a lady that the fire department actually had to come in and rescue because it was about a foot or so or 2 feet in her house. Oh, in the window pane? Wow, that's roughly almost 3 feet up on a 3x5. But anyway, our scripture today is going to be in Matthew 25, starting at verse 14. But, of course, we're going to look at a few other things. We're going to look at one of Christ's parables today. And this parable has been on my heart for a few weeks now because it's more than what meets the eye. And so, as the teacher of the Word, I want to share with you the in-depth, if I can, or as much as I can, on what this parable is actually talking about. Because usually whenever we look at it and we see it, we think of two different things. We either think of our talents or whether we sing great like the folks up here or do instruments or something along those things, those kinds of talents, if you will. And then we think along the lines of talents as being in money, but there's far more to this parable than just reading the surface, and that's why, of course, we do Bible study so that we can get in our in-depth teaching on the scriptures. And I think there's about 50 parables in the New Testament. There are no parables in the Gospel of John, but they are in anywhere from 30 to 50. Some of them are kind of duplicated in the three Gospels, the Synoptic Gospels, which is Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And I think, and it'll take a while, but I think that's what the Lord wants me to do is just teach on the parables. Because the parables that Jesus taught, and if you read in some of the scriptures, it'll tell us, Jesus himself says, I teach you in parables so those who are unbelievers will not understand. But you, as believers, you should understand it. And so, therefore, again, he teaches in parables. So parables are something that Jesus taught in the physical so that we would learn something in the spiritual. He taught something in the physical that we would understand in order to teach us something that is in the spiritual. And this parable of the talents is exactly that. And we're gonna talk about that in depth today. We might be here. I know the Cowboys are playing at noon, but, you know, you can see the reruns or watch it on the news, right? I mean, it's no big deal. Don't throw anything, okay? I know, it's... Some of you want to be out of here by 11. We're not going to make that. But anyway, also, if you notice, there are some And I think the reason the Lord wanted me to teach on this particular parable, there's some things going on in our world right now that are pretty devastating. The nation of Israel has been attacked and is somewhat under siege, if you will, by a terrorist group. Not necessarily the Palestinians, though some may be Palestinians, and primarily in the Gaza Strip there, they're all Palestinians, because Israel actually, and that was a part of God's promised land. The Gaza Strip is a part of God's promised land to Israel, but Israel actually took and had everybody move out of the Gaza Strip. All Israelites moved out and turned that over to the Palestinians. The Palestinians are a Muslim religion, if you will, or a Muslim nation, and they allow people to come into their nation and rule over them, which are these terrorists. And now these terrorists, not necessarily the Palestinians, but now these terrorists who have suppressed the Palestinians have waged war against God's people, the Israelites, and the nation of Israel. We've seen it on the news. In Genesis 12 and 3, when God promised the land of Israel to Abraham, he said, "I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you, who comes against you. I will curse them." So we must understand and we must take into account God is going to wage war against these terrorists that are coming into Israel and causing all the havoc and causing all the destruction and the killing and the massacre and the almost the abomination of desolation on the people of Israel. If you think about it, they came through at 6:30 in the morning while about 1,000 or a couple of thousand young people were out celebrating what they call the Dance of Peace. It was an annual celebration that the Israelites did. And also many young people came from different countries to celebrate peace. It was a dance of peace. And they attacked these people, and about 260 or so were massacred. They weren't just killed, they were massacred, they were murdered. And then the terrorists, not the Palestinians, but the terrorists, went on a killing spree, murdering innocent people in their homes, all the way from infants to elderly, to the elderly, and kidnapped several of them. We still don't know what's going on with those. Now, I don't bring all this up in order to tell you the bad things that are going on in the world over there, although you should be keeping up with it. And the reason that you should be keeping up with it, and this is not a scare tactic in any way, shape, form, or fashion, but you should be keeping up with it, because do not think for one moment those terrorists are not right here in the United States, because they are. They are here. And at some point in time, we had 9/11 back in 2000. Don't think that we won't have another 9/11. Israel was saying this is our 9/11. Don't think we won't have another 9/11 here in the United States, because we will. I'm not trying to prophesy. I'm not trying to speak anything. But Scripture tells me, not in so many words, but Scripture tells me that if you are a Christian, if you are a believer in Christ, if you are a believer in God, as we believe, and I hope you do, that we are and will be attacked. Just like Israel attacked. It wasn't a matter of taking back the land that belonged to Palestine or the Palestinians, because God gave that land to Israel. over 2,000 years ago, almost 4,000 years ago. He gave it to Israel. So it is not that Israel is occupying the land because they took it away. Israel is occupying the land because God gave it to them. It is their land. And actually, there's a lot more of it that they're going to end up claiming because a lot more of it belongs to them. So don't think, and then the Palestinians are not the Palestinians, I'm going to say, but the terrorists, their job is to not take back the land. Their job or their thinking or their motive or their wants is to kill God's chosen people. That's it. It's not to take back the land. It is to kill God's chosen people. Well, if we support Israel, which we do, and thank goodness we had somebody in Washington that actually stepped up and says, we will support Israel, because I really didn't expect him to say that. But surprisingly, he did. I just hope he does. But my point is that these terrorist groups are out to annihilate God's people. And if you call yourself a child of God, then you are God's people. And don't think that they won't be after us as well, because they will. They will. So we can't be shocked or scared or amazed at what is going on in Israel, because it's all been pre-prophesied and spoken by Christ in Scripture. In chapters 24 of Matthew, we're not going to go there, but in chapter 24 of Matthew, Jesus said this is going to happen. This is going to happen. So again, this is not a scare tactic, but do not think that these terrorists are not here in our own backyard, because they are. They are. But maybe this message today, I hope, will open some eyes here in the United States to the truths that are in the Bible of the last times in which we live. Because we have so many. I saw a deal with the College of Tulane. That just happens to be the one I saw. But I heard that there were others, to where people were protesting against Israel. And they're Americans. They're not Islamic. They're Americans. They're just following or going along with the Islamic people who live up there. And by the way, we have tons and tons and tons and tons and tons and thousands upon thousands of Islamic people living in our U.S. We have them in our Congress. Okay? And they are speaking out against Israel. Why they're still in Congress, you got me. And I don't want to get into a political thing, but it's our administration is the sorriest administration I've ever seen. I didn't say that, did I? But the problem is that we have many, 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 and we are a melting pot. We're a melting pot of many, many different religions and beliefs and ideals and such and etc. But we have a major population of Islamic people, and if they are, how do you say this, not the true Islamic people, but the people who have gone by the wayside, if you will, of Islamic religion, their job, their thinking, their mission is to kill God's people. Now, there are Islamic people that follow a peaceful religion, if you will. And I don't want to get into all that, but my point is that we have to be aware that this is in our country by the thousands upon thousands upon thousands. Don't be fooled. Don't be sitting there with your eyes closed. Don't be thinking this is not or can't happen here, because it most certainly can. And I hate to say, but I do believe it most certainly will at some point. And Jesus spoke of all of this. In our Wednesday night Bible study, we just finished studying the book of Revelation. And we studied in detail about the last day, the last times, in which Jesus warns us about the end times. To clarify, the last times are actually from his resurrection and ascension to his coming back. That's the last time. It's called the church age. We sit there and we think, oh, well, we're in the last time. We've been in the last time. Whenever Jesus left this earth until he comes back, that is the last times. Now, we have what is the last days. Well, we don't have a figure, if you will, of what the last days are. I can't tell you it'll be 5 days, 10 days, 20 days, 1,000 days. We don't have that because we don't know when Jesus is coming back. But those last days are the last days prior to his coming back. And if you look at the signs of the times, we're not just in the last times, we're in the last days, according to the scriptures. So again, we have to be aware of what's going on. The last days are an unknown number of days just before his return, which will happen when, according to scripture, the number of Gentiles is fulfilled. Those who are Gentiles, you and I, not Jews, but those who are Gentiles who come to belief and faith in Christ Jesus. When that last number, and we don't know the number, and it could be you, it could be your brother, your sister, your aunt, your uncle, your kids, it's whenever it is. We don't know. But it tells us that whenever that last number of Gentiles is fulfilled in Romans 11:25, Christ will come back. The rapture will then happen. The rapture you can find, we talked about this a good while back. We talked about it in our Wednesday night Bible study. The rapture is chapter 3.5, if you will, between chapters 3 and chapter 4 in the book of Revelation. After chapter 3, and then you go into chapter 4 where John is in heaven. And then in chapter 4, from chapter 5 all the way up until chapter 19, when Christ comes back on the white horse and we come back with him, the church is never mentioned again. So all through the tribulation period, the Bible tells us the church will not be here during the tribulation period. Are you a part of the church? That's the question. I pray you are. Revelation 6 through 20 is when God is going to pour out his wrath on the sinful earth. His church will not be here. His church will be with him. Jesus explains to us the signs of the times and the end of the age in Matthew 24. If you want to write this down, you can cross-reference it. It's in Matthew 24. It's in Mark 13. And it's in Luke 21. Now, I want to go to Luke 21 momentarily. You don't have to go there. But in Luke 21, and you might want to just jot this down, in verse 20 it says, "But when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, you know that its desolation is near." You know that it is near. Now I'm going to jump over to verse 34 through 36. "But take heed to yourself, lest your hearts be weighed down with carousing, drunkenness, cares of life, that the day come upon you unexpectedly." Now what he's saying there simply, and this is Jesus speaking, he's saying there, don't be so busy in your own world, if you will, that you don't realize what's going on around you. "For it will come as a snare to on all those who dwell on the face of the whole earth. Watch therefore and pray always that you may be counted worthy to escape all these things that will come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man." Now Jesus is giving us fair warning there. He says, you better be aware of what's going on and you better be ready. You better be ready because it's going to happen. We already see Israel being surrounded, do we not? They've got Syria up here. They've got Egypt down here. They've got Iraq and Iran over here. They're pretty much surrounded by now. And we believe that most of these terrorists are sponsored through Iran. It's happening, friend. Don't think that it's not happening, because it is. Oh, does that mean that Jesus is coming back in a couple of days? Well, we don't know. You know, this war, if you will, or whatever, could go on for another 1,000 years. We don't know. That's not the point. The point is to be ready. It is to be ready. We must be ready. Because if we're not, guess what? We get left behind. We will study today in the book of Matthew, chapter 25. But in Matthew 24, 3 through 51, Jesus speaks to us concerning the last days. He speaks of us about the tribulation period. He speaks to us about the last days. He speaks to us about his return, and even about the last day or hour, which no one knows but is to come. So Matthew 24 is very important that we understand it, and you can also find it, Luke 21 and Mark 13. But Matthew 24 is probably the best interpretation, if you will. The hour is to come. It will come. It's an imperative phrase, because it is not yet here, though it will be, and it is almost here, as we can tell by the signs of the times. Jesus is coming back. According to the Word of God, which is truth, he is coming back, but yet we know not when. So we are to be ready. This is the message. This is the message. We are to be ready. So let's look at our scriptures for today. Matthew 25. If you were to just simply read over this parable, unless you study through this parable, you would simply think it's talking about making money. It really has nothing to do with money. As a matter of fact, a talent is not even money. I'll explain that in just a little bit. It's not even money. And you would think, if you don't think money, you would think, okay, well, it's that I can, like our praise and worship team, I can sing like our praise and worship team. That's my talent. I'm good. I wish I could, but I can't. Or you can think, well, it's because, and I'm going to use me, if you will, because I'm a carpenter, and because God has given me lots of skills to be a carpenter. Or as Robert, he's a truck driver. He knows how to take those big, 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 big tractors and haul them all over the country, which very few people, even truck drivers, can actually do, because there's a lot more involved than just steering the steering wheel. Or like some of you who may be secretaries, or ranchers, or electricians, or bankers, or storekeepers, or whatever your talent happens to be. That's not what the scripture is talking about. It's not talking about how good you are at whatever it is you do. You know, most Christians, when people ask them, says, well, what do you do? Who are you? They'll say, well, I'm a carpenter. Well, what do you mean you're a carpenter? The right response on my case should be, I'm a child of God. That's who I am. I happen to be a carpenter also, but I am a child of God. But see, most of us refer to ourselves as to whatever we do. Johnny, he's a carpenter. He's a good carpenter. But he's a child of God first. He's a child of God first. Mike back there is a rancher. He has a farm. He raises animals and takes care. You could say he's a husbandry to animals. No, first and foremost, he's a child of God. I don't mean to leave off Sandy, because she probably does more work than he does, you know. But my point is that we need to realize who we are first, if we are who we are. Okay? See, that's the whole key. Are you a child of God? Or are you a carpenter? Are you a child of God or are you a rancher? You see what I'm talking about? We are a child of God. We better be a child of God. I hope you are. But in chapter 25, starting at verse 14, now I want to, before we actually get started, I want to speak, because we're going to go verse by verse, and we're going to look at this, and we're going to dissect it and talk about it. This is how you learn Scripture. You dissect it. You don't just read it. You dissect it. You study it. You discern it. Instead of using a traveler to a far country, a man traveling to a far country, instead of using that, I'm going to use what Jesus is really talking about. He is talking about himself. He is that man who is traveling to the far country. The far country he is traveling to is back to heaven. When he returns, the traveling man to another country, when he returns, is Jesus returning to this earth. So that we understand where I'm, the subject that I'm talking about is not a guy traveling to Mexico or traveling to Israel or somewhere like that. It is Christ. That's what the Scripture is teaching. It is Christ. It is talking about a physical man, but it's teaching the spiritual lesson of the return of Jesus. So I'm going to use it in that tense. So just follow along with me, if you will. Starting at verse 14. For the kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling to a far country who called on his servants and delivered his goods to them. Delivered his goods to them. Now, what Jesus is talking about is he shared his wealth with them, not for safekeeping, but to multiply his wealth. But to multiply his wealth. That's the physical. This guy shared his wealth with his fellows, with his servants, in order to multiply his wealth, to make him richer, if you will. And we think of these talents as money, and I'm going to explain that here in just a little bit when we get into the next scripture or the next verse. But God is teaching, we are God's treasures. Exodus 19:5. We are God's personal treasures. So this is Christ giving us the great commission to build his kingdom. This is God sharing the riches of, this is Jesus sharing the riches of God so that we may be blessed, so that we can go out and share it with the world. And the Holy Spirit, not us, the Holy Spirit will call those unto him, unto God, and it will build God's kingdom. Simply put, you're called to go out and testify in order that the Holy Spirit touch a life and hopefully they come to salvation through Christ. That's how simple it is. This is not about a guy traveling to another nation, giving some money to his buds. This is about God using you. This is your calling on your, this is your, I'm not going to say talent yet, but I'm going to say talent. This is God using you for his good pleasure, which is what Scripture tells us for. You are created for his good pleasure, which he deemed for you before the beginning of time. Ephesians 2:10. This is your purpose, to be used by God. You're the servant. I'm the servant. God is the man. Jesus is the man traveling to a far nation or to heaven. Verse 15, and to one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to each according to his ability, and immediately he went on the journey. Immediately he went on the journey. He dispersed his money, I'm going to use it in the physical, he dispersed his money to his servants, so that he could go on his journey and leave them in charge, stewardship, leave them in charge of the money that he gave them so that they could use it to build his kingdom. We're using the physical now. We're using the physical. Just to let you know, In today's monetary denomination or monetary totals or amounts, a talent is a measurement of weight. Is a measurement of weight. It's about 70 pounds. It's about 70 pounds. So if you figure what God or what the man gave the first guy, he gave him 5 talents. So he gave him about 350 pounds, tentatively of silver. He gave the second man about 140 pounds of silver. And he gave the third man about 70 pounds of silver. So a talent here in the physical is not a amount of money. It's a weight of money. I've investigated it and figured it out. And if it were gold, which only the royal people could use, it has to be silver. But if it were gold, it would be in the billions of dollars of today's money. In the billions. Because of the price of today's gold. And gold was only used for royalty, to use as they wanted. It was not just given out. So most likely it was of silver. And silver is used most commonly for the lay person, if you will, throughout the scriptures. So if it were of silver, in today's value, the 5 talents of silver, which is about 350 pounds, would be worth about $140,000. What would you like if somebody gave you $140,000? Hey, go use this. But remember, it's not for your good, it's for his good, right? And then 2 talents is about $56,000, and 1 talent is about $28,000 in today's money. So let's use that as the physical and as a perspective to understand what this guy gave him. And the reason we want to understand what that this guy gave him so much is because, again, you are treasures of God. You can't put a price on you. Jesus paid the price for you. He values you in an enormous amount. So we can look at it as $140,000, but to you, you're so much more valuable than that to God. So we learn something spiritual here. God puts a very, very high price on you. A very high price on you and on me. And it's certainly not 5 talents of silver. It's far, far more. It was the price of Christ. Life. That's how much he values you. He used the measurement of silver so that we could not be blown out of the water, I think, with our imagination thinking, oh man, I'm worth just billions and billions of dollars. Well, you're worth the price of our Lord's life is what you're worth. Let's keep that in our mind, okay? It was a lot of money back then, though, which gives us the semblance of the value treasure that Christ entrusts us with. It gives you the value of the treasure that Christ trusts us with. If I asked you a minute ago, what if somebody gave you $140,000? Or what if somebody gave you $1 billion? What would you do with it? I might get me a truck first, but a new truck. I said might. And believe me, I have a lot of things that I could do for this, for God's church. That is always first foremost in my heart. I have plans for an addition out here that will blow you out of the saddle. Anyway, I could get onto that because I'm praying God will supply, and we could use it for our ministries and such. But anyway, I knew I'd go down that road. Just pray for God's abundance, really, okay? Just do that, please. But God entrusts us with $140,000 worth of silver, or $56,000 worth of silver, or $28,000 worth of silver. I'm going to say that he trusts Linda with $140,000, and he trusts Kathy with $56,000, and he trusts me with $28,000. Well, why wouldn't God give me what he gives Linda? Because remember back over in verse 15, it says, according to their ability. According to their ability. Which means, according to what you're able to do. Now, I know most of y'all know Miss Rose back here, who's not here today, and that concerns me. Hopefully she's just cold and won't stay at home. But Miss Rose has to walk around in a walker, with her walker, which she likes that Cadillac walker. And she's not able to go out here and run up and down the roads and evangelize. I am. I can do that. Brent can do that, and he does it. Maybe you can, maybe you can't. Maybe there's something, though, that you can do that you're not doing. Wouldn't be what I do, but it would be what God has called you to do. And that's what the Scripture is trying to teach. The Scripture is trying to say, teach, God is not planning on you to be me and me to be you. He is asking for you to be you and do what you can based on your ability in order to build his kingdom. The whole question is are you doing it? God expects a return. What did he give you? The breath of life itself. Right? What did he give me? The breath of life itself, the ability to walk, the ability to talk. I wish he'd give me the ability to sing, but he didn't. So I can't do that. But the ability to talk to people and the ability, it was a long time coming, but the ability to stand before people. Several years ago, I would not be here. But God, through different things in my life, is putting me in front of crowds in order to not be intimidated about crowds. Because I could speak to thousands and it wouldn't bother me. Or I could speak to one and it wouldn't bother me. But see, I can speak to thousands or I can speak to one. So can you. Maybe only two for you. Maybe only three for you. Maybe your family. Thanksgiving is coming up, right? You're going to have a bunch of folks over. How about speaking a little bit of Christ there? How about speaking a little bit about God's kingdom there? Let's say we usually have anywhere from 20 to 30 people at our house. Believe me, they all going to hear it. Well, come on. It's all right. We always have room. But my point is that whatever God has enabled you to do, that you are to do. And I don't know what it is. That's between you and him. But the thing is God has given you life. Do you realize that without God's grace, you wouldn't even be breathing here today? You would not even be alive. God created you in your mother's womb. Your mom and dad didn't do it. God did it. Oh, you're getting a little too technical there, Woody. Hey, I'm telling you. God is the one that brought y'all together, your parents together, to create you at the particular time they came together. Don't think he didn't. That's God's plan. Whether you believe it or not, it still is his plan. And God has a plan for your life. And God has given you life. And he expects a return from your life, the gift that he has given you. We're going to find out what kind of return some do and some don't. In verse 15, it also states that he gave each according to his own ability, which tells us that we are each given a measure of responsibility in the building of his kingdom. You're here to build his kingdom. You have a certain measure of responsibility according to your ability to build God's kingdom, and then I have another measure. It's not the same. It's different. I mean, I wish I could be a Billy Graham. I wish I could be a John MacArthur. I wish I could be R.C. Sproul. I wish I could be far better than what I am. But I'm working on it. Are you working on it? Are you trying, not a better person for yourself, a better person for God? Are you working on that? Are you just saying, oh, well, I'm going to heaven? Are you? Are you? We'll see. We're all given a portion. We don't all have the same task. We don't all have the same calling. Therefore, God expects different results from each of us. But he does expect positive results. He expects positive results. He is gone. While he is gone, implies that he will come back and he will judge and he will examine where each of us are at and what we have done. In verse 16 and 17, says, then he who had received the 5 talents went and traded them, and he made another 5 talents. And likewise, he who had received 2 gained 2 more also. So one that was given 5, one was given an abundance, one was given a lot. And he took out, he was a good steward. God gave him there. I'm going to use the physical. The man gave him the gift of the money and says, go out and make me some more money. That's why I give it to you. That's why you're here. In the spiritual, it's the exact same thing. God has given you a life, the life that you have. Now, you may have messed it up like I did, but he has also has given you an abundance in life. You're blessed. Don't think you're not blessed. If you have $10 in your pocket, you have more than 3/4 of the world. So you're blessed. Whether you like it, whether you understand it or not, or whether you receive it or not, you are blessed. So what are you going to do with that? God, I'm going to use Johnny and me because Johnny lets me pick on him and he doesn't get too mad at me. Johnny's given 5 talents. He goes out and he produces 5 more talents. He's got 10. God says, whoo, way to go, buddy. Good job, good job. He gives me 2 talents. And I go out and I produce 2 more talents. And he goes, woohoo! Good job, way to go, buddy. Wait a minute. Why didn't he say, Woody, what the heck didn't you make more for? Is that what God says? No. Because in Scripture tells us that. Just as plain as day, Scripture tells us that. Keep trying to go to the wrong page. Verse 18. But when he had received, the one who had received 1 talent dug a hole and hid the Lord's money. After a long time, the Lord of those servants came and settled accounts with them. So when he received 5 talents, the one who had received 5 talents brought 5 other talents, saying, Lord, you delivered to me 5 talents. Look, I have gained 5 more talents besides them. And what did the Lord say? Well done, good and faithful servant. Well done. You were faithful over a few things. I will make you the ruler over many things. Look at this line here. Enter into the joy of your Lord. In other words, I'm just going to do this real quick because this is basically how I see God doing it. Stand up a minute, Robert, if you will. God doesn't come up and say, well, that was a good job, man. I'm so proud of you. That's not what God did. God comes up and he goes, man, you're my man. You're my buddy. You're my man. I love you. That's what God does. You see, when you work for God, you are working because you love God. And God loves you more than you love him. Scripture tells us that. So whenever you bring your offerings, I'm going to put it that way, bring your return of his stuff, you bring it to him, God doesn't say, good job, bud. Now go make me some more. It's not what he says. Man, he'll throw his arms around you and just, I love you so much. I love you so much for loving me. Because we got to remember the spiritual. We're not talking about money. Whenever you bring someone to Christ, because you have gone out and simply said, let me tell you what God's done for me. When you bring someone to Christ, Scripture tells us all of heaven rejoices. All of heaven rejoices. All the angels in heaven, all the old saints that are up there right now, all those men, heaven rejoices from one end to the other when you bring one sinner home. And God says, well done. Well done. Good job. Come in. Come in to the joy of the Lord. Amen. I want to hear that. I want to feel that. I want to know that. I want to know God says, and I know what I've done in the past, so I know that I don't even deserve any of it. But that's not what the Scripture tells me. The Scripture tells me that if I do God what God has put on my life, he is going to say, well done, good and faithful servant. Come and enjoy. Come and enter the joy of the Lord. Wow, that's what I want. That's what I want. Well, what if you're only got one talent and you dug a hole and put it in the hole? Sorry, I'm very dry. So that's the physical. You dig a hole, you stick it in the hole, cover it up. Ain't nobody know where it is but me. Did you hear what I said? Nobody knows where it is but me. So I'm not going to share it. I'm going to keep it to myself. I'm not going to get it to anybody. I'm not going to tell anybody. I'm not going to even... Oh, I don't even go to church. I'm not going to let anybody know I believe in Jesus. I don't want to be one of them Christians in front of my friends, because they may say, oh, you're one of them Christians. You believe all that stuff? Dig a hole. Take your salvation. Take your gift that God gave you. Stick it in a hole. Keep it for yourself. When you get to heaven, you'll hear, well done, good and faithful servant. Man, you've done such a great job. I'm so proud of you. I know I just gave you a little bit, but you know what? I'm just going to pour out even more on you. Come into the joy of the Lord. Is that what he said to that guy? I don't think so. I don't think that's what he said. I got way ahead of myself here. Let's see. Is it 22? Okay. He also who had received two talents came to the Lord. Okay, I kind of went over that. Well done, good and faithful servant. You did what is right. All right, 24. Then he who had received one talent came and said, Lord, I knew you were a hard man, reaping where you had not sown and gathering where you had not scattered seed. And I was afraid. So I went and hid your money. I went and hid your talent. I went and hid your blessings. I went and hid your gift. I dug a hole in the ground and I stuck it in there. But you know what? I'll go and get it and I'll bring it back to you. And I'll say, see, here it is. Everything you gave me is right here. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Well done, good and faithful servant. I don't think that's what he said. Verse 26. But the Lord answered and said to him, you wicked and lazy servant. You knew that I had reaped where I had not sown, and gathered where I had not scattered seed. Now what Jesus is doing there is he's repeating to the guy his own condemnation. Lord, I know that you reap from where you don't sow. I know that you harvest, but and you don't even plant the seed there. But what did the Lord do? The Lord said, I give this to you to produce a return. I own everything that there is. I own the land. I own the seed. Everything that is His, is God's. And He has given you a portion of it in order to go out and try to get Him a return. And yet you stick it in a hole which is down in your very soul and you don't want to share it with anybody else. You want to keep it hidden so you don't want to get embarrassed. You don't want anybody to maybe take a little bit of it. You want to make sure that you hang on to it because it's yours. It's not yours. It belongs to God. And so the man says, I'll go back and I'll get it. Now, here it is. Here it is. I'll give it all back to you. And he condemned the man for knowing that God expected a return. When we stand before God, God is going to say, where's your return? How have you multiplied what I have given you? How have you blessed the world? Because remember when Jesus hung on the cross, he said, it is finished. He said, it is finished. My work is done. I go to be with the Father. And of course, we know, Scripture tells us that He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, interceding for you and I. See, He's still blessing us. Because He's telling the Father, I'm going to use Johnny because Johnny's more of a knothead than me. Johnny is a knothead. What are we going to do with him? And Jesus says, he's with me. He's one of mine, Lord. And God the Father says, oh yeah, I see you in there somewhere. There you are, Jesus. I see you in Johnny. I guess he's one of ours. He just needs more work than what Woody does. And that ain't true. Okay. But you get my point, right? You get my point. We all need work. But what we do have, we can work with. Because God tells us that He will supply all of our needs according to the riches and glory in Christ Jesus, right? He does. And in Philippians 1:6 tells us that God, what He has started in us, He will bring to completion. He will provide everything we need for everything He's asked us to do. He will not ask you to do anything that He has not provided the necessities for you to do. But you got to do it. He ain't going to do it. You got to do it. So what did He say to this knothead? Well, He said, but the Lord answered and said to him, you wicked and lazy servant. Why would you not do what I ask you to do? You knew that I don't sow and plant where I reap and harvest. And I'm not supposed to because I gave it to you to do. I gave it to you to do. And you kept it in your soul. Instead of letting me reap a harvest with what I have given you and put in you and done for you. Do you not realize I died for you? Do you not realize I took all of your sins? Do you not realize I took all of your sicknesses, all your transgressions, all your illnesses? I took everything that is negative. I took death away from you. I took death, the second death, I took that away from you. And I took it upon myself so that you could live forever and ever and ever and ever. The gift of eternal salvation, I gave it to you. But you had to receive it. And then you had to do something with it. Why do you have to do something with it? Well, it's very simple. Over in Matthew 7, Scripture tells us, you shall know them by their fruit. You shall know them by their fruit. Which Jesus is saying, now, I know, and I think, as I understand it, a nut is a fruit. And you don't have to hang from a tree to be a nut. But Scripture tells us that you will know them by their fruit. So what is your fruit? Are you keeping it all to yourself, by yourself, within yourself? Or are you going out and sharing with others in hopes that that little seed will get planted, God will make it grow, you don't have to do anything but plant it. Plant that little seed, let God grow it, and manifest itself into a good return, a positive return, or a good fruit produced by the seed you planted. And Jesus will harvest the fruit. James 2, I can't think of the scripture. James 2, I think I actually wrote it down. I could probably find it better or quicker. I can find it in my notes. And I do want to, you know this scripture. James 2, starting verse 14 through 26. 14 through 26. Work without faith. Work without faith. Faith without works is dead. How is anybody going to know that you belong to Christ unless you go out and present it somehow, some way, some shape, form, or fashion? Your deeds, the things that you do, the example you portray, the walk you walk, the talk you talk. How is anybody going to know that you're of Christ unless you do something? Now, we know you're not saved by works, except for Jesus' works. But you must present yourself to others as true believers, as children of God, by the deeds that you do or the works that you do. Because your faith is not proven to anybody else because you say, oh, yeah, I got all the kind of faith that I need. I got all faith. I'm nothing but faith. I'm a walking faith. Well, what is your walk like? What are you doing for the kingdom of God? What are you portraying for the kingdom of God? How is God going to reap a harvest if you're not out there planting seed? If you're not doing what you need to do? What He has called you to do? Jesus goes on and He says, look, you ought to have deposited, verse 27, you ought to deposit my money with the bankers, and at my coming, I would have received back my own with a little bit of interest. Well, why didn't you even go to the bank and put it in the bank so that I'll get 0.00006 interest, which is about what banks are paying now? Okay? But why didn't you do something? You did nothing. You buried it. You took it and you buried it in your soul. And you kept it. You kept it because you were afraid to step out. You're afraid to step out and do what I've called you to do. So therefore, I have gained nothing. Jesus further replied, so take the talent from him and give it to him who has 10 talents. Give it to somebody who's going to do something with it. Not necessarily, now the scripture says the 10 talents, but not necessarily the 10 talent guy. Give it to somebody who has 2 talents. Give it to somebody who has 3. Give it to somebody who has 4. Give it to somebody who has however much. Give it to somebody who's going to produce a harvest. Give it to somebody who's going to produce a return. So in other words, if you're not going to work for God, why in the world should God work for you? Are you working for God? I hope so. Today you could start. It'd be very, very simple. All you have to do is do it. You will receive, I'm prophesying this, and I'm not a prophesier, you know. I only speak what God's Word says. Paul tells us that each and every day we receive, or we come into, or we run into, or whatever you want to call it, we have an opportunity to present Christ to somebody, some way, somehow, some shape, form, or fashion. Well, guess what? Today, you're going to recognize that. If you're out and about today, you're going to receive an opportunity to show Christ to somebody. I pray that you do. I pray that you do. Take from this worthless, lazy, non-producing servant, take what he has. Verse 29. For to everyone who has, more will be given, and he who will have an abundance. But from him who does not have, even what he has will be taken away. For he who has, or he who does not have, even what he has will be taken away. Now, what's Jesus saying there? He who has the mindset, oh, I'm saved. I said the words. I said, Jesus, save me. I call on your name. So therefore, I'm saved, right? Well, if you don't know Scripture, that is in Scripture. Call on the name of Jesus and you shall be saved. That's what it says. But that's surface stuff. That's elementary stuff. That's children's church stuff. What it means is, call on the name of the Lord to be the Lord of my life, and I will follow Him. I will sacrifice my life. Jesus says, if you're going to follow me, you must give up your life. You must hate your brothers and sisters. Now, it doesn't mean that he wants you to hate your brothers and sisters and fathers and mothers. What he's saying is that you must hate everything. If you put anything above me, you must learn to hate that, whatever it is. And you must learn to love me, to love Jesus, to love God. He has to be first. The first commandment is thou shalt not have any other God before me. Thou shalt not have any other God before me. And our money, our families, our grandkids, our work, our cars, our trucks, our horses, our cows, our ducks. We can make them our gods. The Cowboys. Come on, Rangers. But you can make anything your God. And if you put that before God, you have nothing. Because what you have will be taken away. Because you don't have God. Now, it's not my call to judge anyone. That's God's job. But he will judge. He will judge. Because he knows who is his and he knows who is not his. He knows the sheep from the goats. So when you stand before God and you give him what he has given you, oh, here it is, here it is. I put it in safekeeping. Man, I put it under my mattress. Nobody knows it's there but me. Or I kept it in my soul and shared it with no one because I'm standing here before you today saying, thank you, Lord, thank you, Lord, thank you. Boy, I'm sure glad I'm here. Aren't you glad I'm here, Lord? Boy, you ought to be glad I'm here. I'm a good person. I'm a really good person. There's a lot of good people in hell. A lot of good people in hell. Why? Because they really don't have. They think they have. Because they go through the motions. They say the words. They sing the songs. They raise their hands. But they really don't have in their soul, in their heart. And that's what Jesus says. But from him who does not have, even what he has will be taken away. Will be taken away. You might think you have Christ. And again, I am not judging anybody. There's no one here on this earth that is your judge. God is your judge. And you are your judge. And you need to find out and think about where you're at in God's kingdom and what you're doing for what He has given you. Because that shows your love. That shows your faith for what He has already done. And for the wicked servant that everything was taken away, verse 30, and cast the, look at this, the unprofitable servant. Cast the unprofitable servant. The one that I poured my life out for, Jesus, of course, the one that I poured my life out for, gave me no return whatsoever. None. Would not, in fear of who knows what, would not step out and share the gospel of Christ so that God's kingdom can be built. That person is the unprofitable servant. God has given you an opportunity by giving you Himself, by giving you the Word, by giving you the message today, to let you know that there is a calling on your life. And that calling is not for you to get everything you possibly can out of life. That calling is to be a servant of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That is your calling. And if you are an unprofitable servant, and I am not judging anybody, I said that third time now, but God says in His Word, and cast that unprofitable servant into the outer darkness. What is the outer darkness? Jesus is the light. He is the light of mankind. John 1 tells us this. John 1 and 3. Cast him into the outer darkness. That means you cast this unprofitable servant as far away from me as possible. Wow. Now let's think about that. Where is as far away from him as possible? That is the deepest, darkest, worst place you could ever be, which is the eternal lake of fire. He's saying, cast them to hell. Over in chapter 3 of the book of Revelation in the church of Laodicea, this is the way that Jesus puts it. He says, if you were cold, I could do something with you. That means if you were a new baby Christian, I can do something with you. I can help you. I can teach you. I can encourage you. I can coach you. I can help you along. If you're hot, then you already have and know what I want you to do, and you're on fire for me. You know and you appreciate what I have done for you. But you are a lukewarm church, Laodicea, and you make me sick to my stomach to the point that I want to vomit you out of my mouth, which is exactly what Scripture says. It uses that word. I don't mean to be gross. That is the word of Christ. It says, I will vomit you out of my mouth. It means you make me sick to my stomach. So you think that God won't cast you into the outer darkness? You better believe He will. Why? Because you're not saved. Because if you were saved, you would either be on fire for Christ or you would be so hungry for Christ that you want to do anything and everything you possibly can in order to bring a positive results or a positive profit, if you will, or to build His kingdom. You would be active in His kingdom. Now, I'm not saying that, oh, yeah, well, I come to church every Sunday. That's active, right? I mean, I'm here doing what I'm supposed to do. I'm supposed to be here every Sunday. I do that. I pay my tithes. It ain't your money, number one. It ain't your church. It's God's church. You're here to build His kingdom. And it's not in here. Everybody in here, I'm pretty sure, is saved. So you're not going to build His kingdom in here. It's out there. It's out there that He wants you to build His kingdom. If you're just coming in here going through the motions, I'm not judging, fourth time. But if you come in here going through the motions, you might not be saved. Because there is no going through the motions. There's what's in here. Because if you have what is in here, then you will do what God wants you to do out there. Because you want to serve God. I can't believe y'all are bundling up. I am burning up. I see y'all. I am burning up. Well, you need to preach next Sunday then, so I guess. Well, I got way ahead of my notes, but that's okay. My point is simply this. I am not, I'll say it for the fifth time. I got to get to seven now. I am not judging anybody. Not at all. But I'm telling you, you need to judge yourself. You need to see where you're at. If you're going through the motions, there's probably some issues. And they're not issues with me, but they are issues with Christ, because He is the judge. And you might want to examine where you're at in your walk. Now, if you're a young Christian, that's okay. This church teaches the Bible. Every time we get together, that's what we do. We teach the Word of God. And we'll be happy to minister to you. We'll be happy to disciple you. We have a men's disciple every Monday night. Discipleship every Monday night. Guys, join us for that. It's great. It's absolutely wonderful. Every Monday night at 6:30, we meet right here. We watch a 15-minute video, and then we discuss what we have watched, and we have some literature that we use, et cetera, et cetera. It's a good program. We're here to help you any way we possibly can. If you're a baby Christian, get into our Bible studies. We're fixing to start the great book of Romans, I think it is, right? Oh, it's Acts. Okay. There's an inside joke there, all right? You have to be in our Bible study to understand it. Well, we're going to start the great book of Acts, the Acts of the Apostles. Join us for that. And you know what? Oh, well, I can't make it that night. I can't make it that night. I can't do this, can't do that. Da, 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 da. Almost everyone knows how, almost. Maybe Johnny and I are not too good at it. But everybody else is probably pretty decent on the internet now. Every one of our teachings, every one of our Bible studies, all that stuff is online right now. Every one of them. Our RCC Bible Study TV, it's online. Our Wednesday night Bible study, it's online, live stream. Today is online. These will be recorded. They will be put in our archive. You can go back. There's no excuse. No excuse. Don't do it on your own there, because we are here to be with you and to help you in your walk. And you help us in our walk as we go along. So if you're a new Christian, or a cold Christian, if you will, start warming up. But go from cold to hot. Don't be lukewarm, okay? Jesus don't like lukewarm. He's already explained that. And if you're on fire for Christ, like many of you are and I am, then you do what God has called you to do. And keep doing it, and hunger to do even more. I was trying to explain a while ago about what I would like to do to build His kingdom through this church, if you will. I mean, I have, give me about, I don't know, how much does that last big prize, like $107 billion, something like that, or what, 1.7, however you say it. Man, we can do some stuff with that. So if that guy, whoever it is in California, wants to donate half of it, I'll take it. My point is that to be on fire for God is not to do all the things. It is to have the desire to do. It's to have the desire. See, it all starts with the desire. If you desire to please God, then you're on fire for God. But if your desire is to come in here and warm that chair, that's not pleasing God. God don't need you here. But God wants you here. But then God wants you to take what you get from here and take it out there. And God will judge that. That's number six. God will judge that. It is up to each of us to do our part. Jesus said on the cross, "It is finished. His work is complete." Now it is up to us to continue His work in these last times before he returns in the last hour, which in seeing the times that are at hand, we are confident Jesus is coming soon. Amen? Jesus is coming soon. So we need to realize, we have a part, we have a purpose, we have a calling while we're on this earth. And it's not just simply to attend church, it's not simply to raise your hands, it's not simply to just, oh, bless you, Lord. Oh, you know, God bless you. That's not what it is. Lord, give me all that you want to give me so that I may take that and produce a good return. A good return. That's what God wants from you. He wants you to produce. If you're not producing, then you're the unprofitable servant. Seventh time. I'm not judging anybody. That's what the Word of God said. Did you see it in your Bible? Amen. That's what the unprofitable servant. And he says, cast him out. Cast him out. To the outer darkness. In other words, Jesus is saying, as far from me as possible, cast him out. I want to produce. I do. Because I want to stand at the foot of Jesus. I want to stand at the foot of Jesus. And I want to hear, well done, good and faithful servant. Well done. And you will hear him call your name. Well done, Johnny. Well done, Robert. Well done, Carolyn. Well done, Linda. Well done, Curtis. Well done, whatever her name is. Kathy. Kathy. Well done. That's what I want to hear. And I pray that's what you want to hear. Well done, good and faithful servant. Because I can't put a price on what he did for me. He gave me life. Eternal life. Not death. Not separation. But I'm going to live forever in the glory of God. And I pray you do as well. But that will only be if you are that good and faithful servant. Pray you are. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, if there's anyone here today who does not know Jesus, don't take it lightly. Don't take it lightly that, oh yeah, Jesus come into my life, be my Lord and Savior. Those are words. Those are simple words. And if you don't mean it in your heart, then they are simply that. They're just words. Simple words. But if you truly mean it in your heart, Jesus promises that he and God himself will come and live in you. That's what he promises us. But you got to call on the name of the Lord with a truthful heart, with a humble heart, with a heart that desires to receive the love of Jesus, the love of God. Just simply say, but mean in your heart, Dear Jesus, I ask you to forgive me of my sins. You said you took them all on the cross and paid for them, so I thank you for that. I ask you to forgive me of my sins. Come into my life. I make you the Lord of my life. I ask you to be my Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you. God bless you all. If anybody needs prayer for anything whatsoever, please come forward and let us pray with you. Because we all need prayer. We need the practice, you need the prayers. Amen? That's what George used to say. I still love that saying. Yep, we'll pray for Crystal. Anybody else? Come on up, Vicky. I'm sorry. I did. I looked over and I thought, what is her name? I've only known you about 11 years. Jeez. All right, we're going to anoint you with the oil as God tells us to do and commands us to do. We continue laying hands on you and continue believing and standing in faith that God is going to heal you. I just want you to know another couple and I yesterday prayed for you diligently, and we are believing that God is going to heal you. We don't know when or how or what, but it's all to His glory, amen? So we're going to lift you up. Father God, we lift up Crystal again to you, Lord, and we're going to continue lifting her up to you, Lord, and we're going to continue believing in faith that you are going to heal her, Lord. We are looking for a miraculous healing. We are looking for a miracle to happen in her body. And we give you all the credit and all the glory, God, because we know it's only you. It's not us. We're just doing what you call us to do, which is stand in the gap and stand on her behalf and believe by faith as a group. We are believing that you will heal her because your word says you will. And so we come to you, Lord, on bended knee and humbled heart, and we ask that happen in Crystal, that this cancer that is invading her body be washed out completely and that she be healed in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you, sister. Amen. 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 Rosemary, you need prayer? Yeah. Yeah. All right. So what you got, Rosemary? Anything in particular?
I had my procedure.
Okay.
I don't have the results yet.
Right.
I believe everything is going to be okey-dokey.
Right. Okay. Good. Amen. Amen. We'll anoint you as well, and we'll pray you up. Father God, we're lifting up Rosemary to you, Lord. We're asking and believing that in faith that she is being healed. This procedure that she had, it was successful, and that whatever it was that was in her body or around her body or on her body or whatever it was, that it is gone. It is washed away by the blood of Jesus, and she is completely healed. And we receive that, Lord, by faith, and we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 All right. Do it. Yeah. Right. We all do. Yeah, we all do from time to time. I do too, so don't think you're the lone wolf, okay? Or the lost sheep, because you're not, okay? We all go through these times. I go through them more than I want. Father, we lift up our sister to you, Lord, and we just ask, Lord, that you fill her heart with the love that you have for each and every one of us, but especially fill her heart with the love that you have for her. Father, we know that life troubles, life woes. I mean, it tells us in the planting of the seeds. It tells us that we will have these troubling times. You even tell us on the Sermon on the Mount that don't worry about tomorrow's troubles because they'll have enough of its own. So we suffer with this, Lord, and we have to go through this. And as we come through it and come out on the other side, we will see that it is just a tool that is used to build our faith. And Father, we know that Kathy is a faithful child of God. She loves you, Lord, with all of her heart, with all her mind, soul, strength. And we ask her, Lord, that you just support her and comfort her and wrap your loving arms around her to give her the peace in her heart, in her soul that she needs, in her spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you, sister. Amen. All right. Anybody else? All right. Come on up. Bobby. Right. Well, don't fall no more.
Yeah, where's your thing? Where's
your
walk?
Yeah, exactly.
I repeat that.
No, you better not.
No.
Because, hey, when you need it, you use it. And then when you don't need it, then you don't need it. But when you need it, you use it, okay? It's just that simple. Now, we have a walker. Do you need it? And will you have a cane if you need just that? Okay. Well.
I fall with those.
Okay. Well, then use your walker. Okay? I mean, it's just that simple.
I got Al.
No. Yes, you have Al, but, okay? You need your walker. Father God, we lift up Bobby to you, Lord. And first of all, I wish and pray, Lord, that you get rid of the hard-headedness. All right?
Thank you.
Lord, because we must understand that whenever we're having issues of balance or joint problems and stuff like that, sometimes we do need a walker and we do need some assistance. And it's only temporary, Lord, but let us be wise and use the assistance that you provide for us, whether it be Al or whether it be a walker or whatever it is, Lord. But let her use that, or encourage her to use that, so that she doesn't fall. Because she can mess up a whole lot more by falling. And that is not a good thing, Lord. Matter of fact, I remember when George fell out in the parking lot over at Tabby's, and we thought maybe he just stumbled. But he fell and he broke his hip. Ended up taking an ambulance ride into the hospital. This can happen to Bobby as well if she doesn't do the right thing. So wise up her mind, please. And let her realize that she can use that assistance and probably prevent a catastrophe. Father, we thank you, Lord, that you will help us out in all things. We look to you for all guidance and direction. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Please use your walker, okay? Seriously. Just temporarily, but use it. But use it. Well, then Al needs to tie a rope around your neck and like this and just lead you around. That way you can't fall backwards. Sure it was. Okay. All right. Oh, I'm sorry, Linda. Yeah.
I have failed twice in the last week. Flat on my face.
You need a walker?
No.
We never do.
And I never know when it's going to do. I flat on my back one day and flat this on concrete, and thank God I wasn't hurt.
Well, maybe you need a walker.
No, I don't need a walker.
No. Okay. Hey, I got you. Okay, I got you. All right? Father, this is two that need softening of the mind, softening of the heads, Lord. I ask you, Lord, though, that you do watch over her and help her and keep her balance and help her walk straight and not fall anymore, because it can be very, very devastating to the body. And Father, I ask you to give her wisdom and strength to walk, and like I said, walk comfortably and walk confidently, Lord, so that she doesn't fall and get hurt. Father, we lift her up to you, and we ask that it be done in Jesus' name. Amen?
Amen.
Okay.
I thought it was my ears. I went and had them.
Go straight
for a
fair. Right,
right. What
about that? Okay. All right. Come on up, Martha. We're going to pray for your son?
Yes.
All right. Anything else?
And his friend
Holly. Woohoo! Go, God, go. Go, God, go. You led her to Christ?
Yes.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Oh, your son too?
Yes.
All of heaven is rejoicing, let me tell you.
There's two more
companies. Amen. All right. Thank you, Lord.
And her husband and her two babies are going to church today with her, so they start.
Good deal, good deal. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We give you thanks and praise, honor and glory for the manifestation of your spirit in these people. Father, we lift the others up to you, and we ask, Lord, that you continue walking with them and guiding them and directing them like we know you will, because you say, once I come into you, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. So, Father, we give you praise and honor for that and thanks for that, as we look forward to those days to where we can get to heaven and we can see those folks, because otherwise we won't see them. And, Lord, man, that is such an awesome thing. Father, I ask you to lift Martha up to you, continue lifting her up to you with the illnesses or the issues that she has in her own body. But even with that illness that she has been dealing with or hurting that she's been dealing with, Lord, she is still out there bringing folks into your kingdom, building your kingdom, Lord. And we know that we don't save anybody. We just plant that seed. But that seed has now been planted, and there's some more crowns that are ready to be given out up there in heaven. We thank you for that, Lord. What a glorious, glorious news. What a glorious day. God, we thank you for being with us and guiding and directing all things. I ask you to continue helping Martha get through the things that she needs to get through, and just be the person that you've called her to be and growing in Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
I thought that was fitting
good.
To let you know since you preached that today.
Yeah. That's great. I am excited. That's good. Anybody else? I don't want to be wrong again. Okay. Good deal.